Right, let's get this thing started. Science 7, welcome back to today's lesson. We are going to continue our chapter 1 and we will probably conclude a little bit of chapter 1 today and then move on to chapter 2 hopefully. Before I start everything, I'd like to go through what you guys did as a question science log activity number 8. So in this question, I ask Mr. Kim said, gravels, a larger grain of sediment can be generally found in upstream compared to fine grain like sands can be found in the lower stream. And I ask you explain why. So related to this, without further ado, let me draw some diagram. So for instance, and this is a sea. We know that when it comes to precipitation, or any type of glacier, they're located on the top of the mountain. Think about any type of Rocky Mountain range too, to be fair. So the direction of the stream goes up to down all the way to the bottom. Now, if you think about the size of the grain, imagine gravels are this size. Then sand is just the size of a dot, as you can see. Which one do you think will travel further? It's more about that question. If you think about it, all of those grains that you see, which is our fine sediment, those are sands. So they are light. They're not heavy. So that means you can travel further distance. This is one of the reasons why you see a lot of sand around the coast area. On the other hand, when it comes to gravel, they will probably stay along on the way that they're produced, or they just carry a little bit in the upstream to midstream, but not as much down. That's another reason. Second reason is, well, sometimes if you think about it, those big size gravel will be undergoing erosion and weathering, physical weathering, and they will turning into sand too. So second reason that I can think of is physical weathering. So even if some of the gravel that may travel down, they may end up being sand at the end. That's another thing that I want to pay attention to you. So in the last lesson, we talk about gradual erosion. And even erosion, you have several sudden events here. And those are the ones where you see in the news any type of sudden flooding due to high amount of precipitation and any type of landslides, rock slides that is followed by after the mountain fire, for instance. So if I give a real life example of erosion, you guys probably have an experience of scraped knees and so on. This is erosion. We are exposed to the surface, so that's why when it comes to a scratch, that basically attack our surface. On the other hand, when it comes to a prevention of erosion, planting vegetation, contour farming, and reduced tillage can basically decrease the effect of wind erosion because vegetables, any type of plants, they have roots, solid roots. So it can hold those roots to do what I like to call a prevention of the erosion or slowing down of erosion. So erosion, let's think about what glacier does. Glacier can move some of those rock mineral samples from higher area to lower area. And large rock that is caught up in that process is known as erratics. And that's what you see over here. Some people may wonder who brought a big rock from the down to the up. Some of you guys may think it time to time, but it's in fact not done by human. It's done by the nature. It's more up to down situation. So this is, think about it as a chunk bedrock. On the other one, let's constantly talk about the erosion process done by glacier. Because glaciers move up to down situation, so that's, let's see, highlighter up to down, because we are located higher upper ground when it comes to the tip to lower ground, and obviously our good old gravity make that process happen, or speeds things up, if you will. During that time, there are some sediment that push away. So I want you to focus on these guys. Those are the ones that's called moraines. So moraines are the one that is being delivered during the process of erosion. The next erosion effect that I'm gonna show you is bunch of scratch mark that you see on the mountain range, especially when you hike all the way to the top. This is not sediment. Can you see there's a line that is occur like a scratch mark done by your pet? We call it striation. So striation is basically how you pronounce it. Striation is showing any type of scratch made in the bedrock. So I'm gonna highlight this. Physical damage, if you will, and it's done by the glacier. And you cannot see the glacier's shape per se because of one main reason. They actually melted and then go into the water cycle, hydrologic cycle. That's one of the things that you need to remember. When it comes to glacier, one thing that I want you to understand is they always leave behind some sediment. And it's always look like a small hills. The one that you generally see in desert area technically. And that shape look like this. Few stiff going upper ground location for one end, and then the other part is more gradual slope. You always have this stiff slope versus gradual slope. And that's always happened because if I look at the direction of the glacier flow, here's what happened. It carried from gradual place to the up, but after that, it break down and it's gonna make it like a fall situation, if you will. We call this area drumlins, and any type of snake-like hills called S-curves, which is what you're seeing here as an S-curve, and this is what I like to mention as a drumlin. So just know those two types. We have another science log activity. I want you to do that as a homework question rather. Meanwhile, let's move on to our chapter 2. In chapter 2, we're talking about the rock cycle. Yes, rock has cycle. This is one of the reasons why rock is not falling out from sky like the way that you see from water cycle, but you may wonder how some of the rock that you see are ended up all the way to the higher up ground. So we're going to talk about rock's properties, rock type, mineral type, and then some kind of luster type of a rock samples. We're going to look at that, and we're going to go through rock cycle. The first chapter talk about basically what are rocks and minerals. So let's look into that. Similar as before, I want you to do science log activity. This one, I want you to pause the video and do it now. And I'm gonna share some of those example answer. When it comes to this science log question, what can rocks tell us about Earth? Well, there are a few things. There are a few things. And I'm going to go through some of the example that I can think of and what you can benefit. The very first one, rock can actually tell you the time. And some people may wonder, what do you mean by time? Well, age of Earth. If you want to call some time, we call it era. What kind of era of the Earth? Second, by studying the rock, we can actually think about the location of the plate. What I mean by that is, Earth used to be all together, but not anymore. We're gonna learn about that continent, original continent called Pangaea. Third, rock can tell us about basically some kind of ecosystem in past. Some of you guys know about this one, like fossil. They're the ones that hide underneath the rock and other rock like sandwich. We can talk about that a little bit in details too. Those are example questions, or sorry, example answers, if you will. So rock and mineral. First of all, let's think about rock. Rock is made out of tiny little grain particles, like what you see on the upper side and bottom side. Upper side has a black and white, downside have a gray and yellow particles. So rock is made up many little particles that's known as grains. So that's one of them. When it comes to the appearance and properties of a rock, it depends on the nature of grains. It depends on the material of which they're made. So material, if you will. And the building blocks of rock are pure, naturally occurring solid materials called mineral. And some of you guys remember hearing mineral in health class, yet it's not the difference. Mineral that we consume is more ion format. Mineral that is embedded in here are more actual metal situation. But some of them can corrode, so it will be turning out to be ion too. So what are minerals? Well, most minerals are rare if you focus on the one on the right side. But some of the minerals are common. You can find it from our biotic factor, something that we consume. So let's go through some. Minerals can be found as a pure substance. We call it chemical element. Those are the ones where you may heard the term sodium. You may heard about chlorine. Those kind of thing. And at the same time, we can find minerals from something I like to call as compounds. Compounds are combination of elements. So for example, even though you guys will learn more when it comes to a science 8, element is one of them, like sodium by itself. Compounds are something that combine together, like your table salt, NaCl, sodium chloride. So those are something that you may want to have it in your mind. Rocks and mineral combined, there are numerous type of mineral combination that we can think of. It is well known that we have more than 3,500 different types that is identified so far. And some minerals are composing main part of Earth's crust. For example, some known as calcite, quartz, feldspar, mica, hornblende, and pyrite, and dolomite. Pyrites, let's look at our first example, which is known as fool's gold because it is quite bright, like a luster property of any type of metal. That means it's reflecting, it's shiny. Pyrites is known as a brass yellow mineral with a bright metallic luster. So this is one of the reasons why a lot of people thought it was gold at the beginning. It mainly composed of iron sulfide. Anything that has sulfide in it has a little bit of yellowish green color. So that explains about this bottom part. Most abundant sulfide mineral that we have on Earth. Let's take a little pause button and then let's go through what iron and sulfur does. Iron and sulfur is good for our body because iron, first of all, you can get from these materials. So some of the nuts and then some of those fruits and vegetables like broccoli and liver from animal. Iron basically is required because We have red blood cell, and red blood cell has something called hemoglobin at the center, and iron is the one that help carrying the oxygen in there. Sulfur also plays a huge role, and you can find sulfur from egg yolk, most likely garlic, onion, cheese, those kind of material, asparagus. And the thing is, sulfur is useful because we have genetic material called DNA, and then sulfur helps building and fixing the DNA. Second material, minerals if you will, that I like to go through is dolomite, which is known as carbonated rock. So you can see there's some part where it's luster, some part that is a little foggy and pearly because it has a mixture of different chemicals. Dolomite is carbonate mineral that compose of calcium, magnesium, and carbonate. And it is one of those sedimentary rock sample. That means it's one of those that stack layer by layer. I want you to do science log activity, another one, and this will be part of your homework, and you need to answer what do you think sedimentary rock means, and we're gonna share that next time. In addition to that, I want you to do textbook questions 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 on page 366.